Hi everyone. In this episode, I interview Phil Trammell, an Oxford PhD student in economics and research associate at the Global Produce Institute in Oxford. Fun fact, Phil has recently been working with the Collision Brothers, aka the co-founders of Stripe, on patient philanthropy. And indeed, Phil is one of the smartest person I know when considering the intersection of the long-term future and economic growth. Funnily enough, Phil was my roommate a few years ago in Oxford, and last time I called him, he casually said that he had written an extensive report on the econ of AI. A few weeks ago, I decided that I would read that report, which actually is a literature review, and that I would translate everything that I learned along the way into diagrams so you too can learn what's inside that paper. The video covers everything from macroeconomics 101 to self-improving AI in about 30-ish diagrams. I hope you'll find the video useful to learn about the econ of AI and our chat interesting. Without further ado, here's my conversation with Phil Trammell. Hey Phil, how are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
Great. Thanks for being on the podcast. It's been a few months since we've wanted to do this. Today we're going to be talking about the paper you published on the GPI website a year ago called Economic Growth Under Transformative AI. And that's a paper you co-wrote. Can you tell the audience a bit about, what is GPI for those who don't know, and what you do there?
Right. So GPI is an institute at Oxford doing research in philosophy and economics, mainly economic theory, at least at the moment, relevant to people who want to do the most good. So philanthropists in the EA community would be a sort of obvious audience. I'm an econ PhD student at Oxford, and I'm sort of being sponsored by GPI, and I work part-time at GPI. But mainly my work just overlaps with GPI's goals. So the econ research I do as a grad student is the sort of work that GPI wants done. So I sometimes do kind of outreach and so on through GPI, but mainly the two hats just sort of overlap. And so one of the things I did in my capacity as an econ researcher, which is now on the GPI website, as you just mentioned, is this literature review. It's not really an original paper, but a synthesis of work that has been done over the past few years on AI and economic growth.
And that's perfect because the podcast is about AI. So people, I think, will be like kind of familiar with AI or AGI or those concepts. Maybe not with transformative AI if those are not effective altruists. Could you maybe define what you mean by transformative AI in this paper?
Yeah, people have used that term in slightly different ways. What I mean by it is AI that has a transformative effect, and I'll define that in a moment, on the economic growth rate, the wage rate, okay, so growth could stay the same, but people's wages could fall a lot or something, so that would be different, or the labor share. And the labor share is the fraction of output that gets received in exchange for labor. That's received as wages, as opposed to as capital rent. So it's interest on investment. Historically, for a long time now, even as 1,000 things have changed about the economy, about 2/3 of output has gone to labor. It's gotten paid out as wages. So, hopefully that makes sense. Like on average, people's income, 2/3 of it comes from their job as opposed to from their investment. And 1/3 is from investments. And that could change a lot if AI takes off in a big enough way. So those are the three things that could be transformed for if transformed by AI for AI to be transformative on my account. Okay, so what do I mean by transform? It could either, so if a variable that's been constant for a long time falls to zero, I call that a transformative event. So like if the labor share falls from 2/3 to zero. If a growth rate stays constant, so economic growth, say, or wages have been going up at like a few percent a year for a long time. If that falls to zero, that's transformative. Or if the growth rate significantly increases, so if it rises to like 40%, or if it starts increasing without bound, so if instead of jumping as a one-off, you know, event, it goes from 2% to 40%, that would be the previous sort of transformation I mentioned. But it could also be transformed if it just rises without bound. If it goes from 2% to 3 to 4, and then, you know, 100 years later, it's like way higher and it's rising still. And the most radical sort of transformation would be if one of these growth rates, if the economic growth rate or the wage growth rate exhibit a singularity. So this is where it sort of looks like it's going to infinite in finite time. The one caveat I'll say is that that doesn't need to happen literally for the event to qualify as transformative. It just needs to follow that path for a while. If it looks like it's approaching a vertical, if the growth rate, you know, if output seems like it's going to a vertical asymptote, but then it sort of starts flattening off in a long time, once we run out of atoms in the universe or something, then I still count that as transformative.
That still counts as transformative.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. So if we have some the growth rate that doubles after a year, and then it doubles after 6 months and 3 months and a month and a half, we could still consider it to be transformative.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, if it keeps that up for enough iterations, that it just feels like a pretty wild event. I don't have like a precise definition of how far it has to be maintained. So.
I think the your point about the growth rate going to zero being transformative is original. I didn't understand it like that. I thought it was the other cases that kind of transformative. But imagine AI, you know, results in some kind of war, and we have no more growth. Would that still count as transformative?
Yeah, I think that's. I mean, it's not a really practical issue when it comes to a literature review, because none of the papers on growth theory under transformative AI have taken that scenario seriously, so it just doesn't show up on the table. But yeah, I do think that would be a transformation to the world. If AI like kills everyone and then there's no growth, I think that would, you know, that's a transformation.
Yeah, definitely. I think for people where we don't have an econ background, we keep talking about growth rate, and etc. But we might want to define those basic terms, like GDP or growth rate or those things precisely. I think the next slides are exactly about that. Yeah. So yeah, I just put that on so that you could explain what we mean by 2 to 4%. I removed the recessions, so we have something fairly stable between 2011 and 2020, where we just look at the difference in GDP between 2 years of in same quarter.
Yeah.
So could you explain maybe like what's GDP briefly without going too much into details?
Yeah, sure. So it's just the quantity of every good or service that was sold over the past year. Well, yeah, of every consumption good or service, times the price that it sold for. So, you know, you just think of all the haircuts that were given times the cost of the haircuts and the, you know, all the cars that were sold times the cost of each car. You don't want to count all the parts, like if the car was made in a bunch of different, you know, by a bunch of different manufacturers. You don't want, that would be sort of double counting, but you just count the consumption bit at the end.
You don't count the intermediary products like the eggs to make cakes, but only the cake.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, unless the cake was made in the home, in which case you would count the eggs.
Sure. In here, the title is real GDP. And when we say real GDP, we take a fixed prices. Like that, I think people use the dollar, US dollar from 1990s or 2000s. It's fairly common.
Right, right. Yeah, because when there's inflation, you don't want to say that GDP is rising. Or, you know, when there's deflation, you don't want to say that it's falling. You want this measure to track the real increases or decreases to haircuts and cakes and cars. So yeah. You just pick the prices that from 1 year and then you kind of use those to track.
How do you do when you like, imagine Tesla or invent a new car? How do you count the price in the previous dollars?
Right. So there's different ways of trying to do that. You can say, of the goods that were around last year, how many of them are people apparently indifferent between one Tesla and one, and this many of the old things? You know, like let's say people are indifferent between having one Tesla and two old Ford cars from last year. And then this year, a bunch of Teslas are sold, and we can count them each as being two Ford cars. Now, that doesn't actually work. So if you really take that idea seriously, I think you went into all sorts of logical inconsistencies, and for the most part, we just sort of threw them under the rug. But yeah, especially when you're comparing GDP levels over long time horizons, where lots and lots of the products available at the end were not available at the beginning, it might not be possible to do this sort of reasoning, because there might be no quantity of the goods available at the beginning that people would trade for some of the goods available at the end. If you could only have grain and olives and whatever the ancient Romans had, stone, it might be that even an infinite amount of that stuff would not be worth having instead of one car or one nice modern house with air conditioning. So I actually have a paper I've been working on that tries to kind of come up with a sort of alternate framework for thinking about rises in output over time, which you can link to if anyone's interested. But anyway, over short periods, then you can kind of wave your hand and do what I said and say, okay, well, maybe one Tesla is worth two Ford.
Yeah, I'll be happy to link it when it's published. And yeah, I think the next slide gives the like different scenarios. In this slide, we see the growth rate, the GDP per capita for different countries between 2016 and the 1950s. And you see that the average, the global average growth is at 4.4 between those two times. And the US is a little bit less, so between 3 and 4.4. And China is at more than 15 times richer than what it was in the 1950s. So in some sense, we could say that like developing countries have a huge growth and then they go and have a decreasing growth rate until they reach the growth rate of developed countries. Would you agree with that statement?
Yeah, I'd say that when you're not very developed, and in particular when you haven't yet adopted the technologies that more developed countries have, then you can grow just by accumulating capital, just by, you know, piling up all these new sorts of factories that you haven't been making use of so far. So you can exhibit what's called catch-up growth. Developing countries don't all exhibit catch-up growth, You also need the right institutions and so on to allow for all that capital accumulation. But it can allow for it, and that does seem to be what's happened in China. And then once you reach the technological frontier, you'll have to slow down until you're just growing at basically at the rate of technological progress, something like that.
We reached those kind of levels of growth rates since the Industrial Revolution. So there was like some kind of permanent increase since the agricultural and industrial revolution. Do you want to think a bit about that? So like I have a graph from year one to year 2018. You want to explain a bit how that happened?
So for a long time, basically until the, 1700s or something, depending on where, or 1800s, depending on where you draw the line, the world was at pretty stagnant GDP per capita. It was just a bit above subsistence. So the population, when output grew, if you developed a new method for farming to create more calories per acre of land, population would just grow, and GDP would grow, but GDP per capita would stay about the same. It wasn't quite that bad, but it was something kind of like that. So GDP per capita stayed about flat. Then, for reasons that are still very much being debated, in Northwestern Europe, the growth rate really took off, and instead of being next to nothing, it rose to something like 2% per year. This is a growth rate in GDP per capita. And that's made such a difference that, as you can see on this graph, it's just, it's really just almost incomparable, right? What growth has been for the past few centuries compared to what it was before them.
This was because of technological progress in the steam engine, railroad, and so it makes sense that if we build again more transformative technologies such as self-improving AI or even automation of human labor, we could see something similar. Because the steam engine automated some of human labor at some point as well.
Right. So when I said it's not clear why this happened, I guess it's not clear why people went from not developing new technologies very fast to developing them very fast. But everyone would agree that technological progress was the proximate cause of the Industrial Revolution, and that a good way to model, a good way to think about the way in which technology allowed for this explosion in growth is, at least in large part, that it allowed capital to better substitute for labor. So we could now have this stuff that we can just accumulate, we can just pile up without raising the population, that is factories and so on, do some tasks that formerly had needed human minds and hands, so we could have more output per capita.
So that's the second scenario is that you outline is, If we had a similar increase in the growth rate as the Industrial Revolution in the future, that could be considered transformative. But an even more drastic changes are singularity of type 1, where the growth rate doesn't have an upper bound and keeps growing. I think you already mentioned that, but if you want to talk more about that, you can go for it.
Yeah. So I had said that there are three ways the growth rate could rise in a way that was like significant enough to call it transformative. So the first was a significant one-off increase to the growth rate from, let's say, growth rate of GDP per capita. Okay, so yeah, that could rise from, say, 2% a year to something much higher. It could start rising itself without bounds. So this is, I don't think I called it a type one singularity at the time, but this is what it's sometimes known as. Or it could exhibit a type 2 singularity, which is like a true mathematical singularity, where it doesn't just go to infinity but it goes to infinity in finite time. And this seems kind of crazy, but I should maybe remind everyone that, like, even constant growth is crazy indefinitely. In fact, even constant output is crazy. Like, if you really think that it'll last forever, you know, you can't have just output at the current rate past the end of the universe. All of these scenarios are only for a while. And yeah, the idea of a type 2 singularity is just that we follow a curve that resembles this curve that's on the slide here until we start reaching some plateau that's governed by dynamics outside of this model. So about that first possibility, that there's just a one-off increase to the growth rate, that has to be a big enough increase to count as transformative. And I haven't said anything about how big it would have to be. If we have one of the two kinds of singularities, it doesn't matter where you draw the line. 30% growth per year, 50%, whatever. We'll cross it eventually if we take this curve literally. This curve, or the type 1 curve. But if we're talking about a one-off growth rate increase, we want to distinguish between an increase that's just like, you know, it goes from 2% to 2.1%, or 3 to 3.1. We want to distinguish that from something that really makes the world feel different, you know? One way of drawing that line people have sometimes used is to say, we'll call it transformative if the proportional growth rate increase due to AI is as big as or bigger than the growth rate, the proportional growth rate increase induced by the Industrial Revolution. So I said it was basically flat. There was basically no growth in output per capita before the Industrial Revolution. Well, that's not quite true. People sometimes estimate maybe it was around 0.1% per year at the time. And then it was like 2% per year afterwards. So that's a multiple of 20. Another multiple of 20 would be 40% growth per year. So that might be a natural place to draw the line. I think that's a bit high, because even if we had like 39% growth a year, that would still feel pretty wild. And maybe I'd draw it in the teens somewhere, you know, like maybe if we have like 12% or 15% growth, then that's far enough outside the historical norm that it should kind of transform.
Yeah, people often talk about the doubling time in GDP. If the doubling time in GDP is something like a year,
right, that would be drawing the line even higher.
We've been through all those scenarios. I think we are going to go through them even more in the next slides. But yeah, we can maybe start with defining the basics of the models you use for your paper, which is capital, labor, and output.
So we were talking about GDP before, all those cars and haircuts and so on. Mm-hmm. Where do they come from? Well,
from desk.
Some of them come from a desk. I'm at a desk now. They use a lot of inputs, but we can divide them into two categories: labor and capital, where labor is obviously human, you know, human input, and capital is desks and factories and the scissors that the barber uses and all of that. And we have a function, that f there, which takes in all the labor and all the capital and spits out output, you know, the just GDP. So you can think of it as like the whole economy, just a big factory with two big tubes going in, the, you know, the worker, the worker limbs, and the desks and metal and everything, and then it out comes GDP.
Yeah, that's a bit apocalyptic to have humans in tubes, but yeah, I get the idea. Right. Yeah, and I guess to just go back to AI. If AI automates labor and like starts to think like humans and does work like humans, we want maybe to consider them labor. And if we're just like building more computers, then they're more obviously capitals if they're like servers or. So I guess the distinction between those two is less thick for AI.
Yeah, I agree.
So yeah, let's go further. So for this, I just try to, so the little L and K is your notation, is just a derivative, the partial derivative for labor and for capital. And I guess that's if we're assuming that we're paying people their marginal products. So yeah, could you define what's the marginal products?
Sure. The marginal product of a worker is the extent to which output increases, holding everything else the same, when that worker puts in another hour of work, or the amount it falls when they put in an hour less work. And I mean, not an hour, an infinitesimal amount, but let's say an hour. And in a world with competitive markets, as they're called, the worker's hourly wage should be their marginal product per hour in this sense. Why? Well, because if you've got, say, factories around, or you have barbershops around, if a given factory or barbershop or whatever isn't paying someone their marginal product, then they can just go to a similar one across town and say, pay me a bit more, and they'll be willing to. So yeah, things don't always work out that neatly, but I think it's a good place to start. So that's the marginal product of labor and why you should expect it to be the wage. By the same token, the interest rate should be the marginal product of capital. So the annual interest rate should be, let's say I have some equipment that can be used in a factory, or have some scissors or something, and I lend them, I lend it to the, let's say it's scissors, I lend them to a barbershop.
Very nice of you.
How much? Well, but I'm going to get paid.
Oh, yeah.
How much am I going to get paid? The extent to which they're able to make more money over the next year because they have an extra pair of scissors. So that's marginal product of capital, and that should be the capital rental rate or the interest rate, same thing.
Yeah, so I guess more interesting are when you start to insert technology into that, and so you can either have multipliers for capital augmenting technology, or multipliers for labor. So labor augmenting technology. How do you distinguish those two intuitively?
Let's say we come up with a way to reorganize the factory, the big, mm-hmm. the metaphorical big factory of the economy, which has mm-hmm. two tubes going in and it's one tube coming out.
With human limbs.
Yeah. We reorganize it so that the same amount of output comes out the other end if we use half as much capital going in as before, let's say. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you still need to put in the same amount of bodies, but now you can just put in half as many screws and scissors and stuff.
Okay.
And the same output comes out as before. Then we'll call that a doubling to capital augmenting technology, a doubling to A in this slide. Does that make sense? Because now you only need half as much K to get the same Y.
Right.
Holding the B and L constant.
But this technology is still a bit surprising. How could we need half less screws?
Oh, well, this happens all the time. I mean, it takes a lot less metal now to make a car than it used to back in Ford's day. Somehow we've come up with ways to just shape the, structure things, shape the car itself, so that the pieces can all be thinner and lighter and not use as much metal. And that's also good for gas efficiency.
I think for production of materials, or for cars, for products, it's quite easy to measure it. I think in your paper you mentioned that to measure technological development in general, sometimes it's very it tend to be very hard because it can be like, have like very long term repercussions. Like I think you said, the importance of the atomic bomb is not well approximated by the cost of the Manhattan Project. Mm-hmm. So yeah, when you were writing this, what were you thinking about the other consequences or externalities of the atomic bomb?
Naively, you might say, how important, in some economic sense, is a given technological advance? Well, I mean, that's not naive. That's a reasonable question. The naive thing would be to then say, well, it's going to be reflected in how much people were willing to pay to develop it. So if you've got car companies and they're making their cars and they, you know, you see that they don't just spend on steel and on workers to put the steel, you know, into shape to make a car, but they also hire some engineers to think about how to make the same car with less metal. Mm-hmm. You might say, well, how important is this new design that where they save some money, you know, on metal when making the car? Well, we can just say, well, how much were they willing to spend on engineers mm-hmm. to come up with this? That should be something like how much they saved. Because if they're saving more than they spent on the engineers, then it's sort of like they have some market power. Like they could have invested in even more engineers, and okay. they probably would have been saving more money, you know, on that market. So at first glance, you might think, okay, the value of the invention is something like, at least for sort of marginal inventions, for things that mm-hmm. The company was just indifferent between funding and not funding. Those are the ones where the cost is about the same as the extent to which it actually increases output. But for all kinds of technological advances, their impacts are not captured by the people funding them. They have lots of impacts on the world. And so, and those impacts are like many, many steps removed from the organization or individual deciding how much to spend on it. And then, you know, they might be totally unforeseeable and have ramifications through the generations. And it would just be silly to use this framework very widely. And as an extreme example in which that sort of framework would break down, you can consider the Manhattan Project, which introduced atomic weapons to the world. And I mean, I don't know how much the U.S. government spent on the Manhattan Project, but it's not like you can say that if you're trying to figure out, like, what are the most important ways in which atomic weapons changed the world, looking into how much Einstein got paid is, like, not going to go very much.
Sure. yeah, probably not that much compared to the value of winning a war.
Right.
And yeah, I guess when I, like, for me, I ask you to distinguish the two because when I try to think about, you know, like what AI could bring or, you know, in the internet or, you know, when people use emails or Slack and build new servers, new software, they're kind of things that so they can, like, make computers go faster and more efficient, and they can also make... if my computer is faster, the human using the computer will also be more efficient. So it will be like a labor computing technology. But like in some sense, if we have some innovation that enables to, you know, make all the computers twice faster, it will both make capital and labor better off, I believe.
Well. The difference between making a certain factor or its owners better off and making it more productive. In fact, if this production function F here, if for F, capital and labor are what are called gross complements, meaning that basically you really, if you have a lot of one thing, you don't really need any more of that thing. You just need the other thing. You know, it's like left shoes and right shoes, right? If that's how capital and labor are, you know. Then making a certain factor more productive is bad for the owners of that factor, and making the other factor more productive is good. So, if you've got a factory, right, and you've got like, you've got machines and people, and you need one person per machine, and then you say, you know, you suddenly come up with labor augmenting technology that now means you only need half as many people. You come up with a new training, say, so the workers can operate twice as many machines at once. Then you can just fire half the workers. And what happens to the wage? Well, it goes way down because no one, no one's really all that necessary. You've got this sort of surplus of labor.
So you're saying that like there's some kind of interaction between those two, where if one becomes more productive or efficient, then you can just like remove the other one or remove half of it.
Yeah. I mean, so that's in a static setting. Now, when you really think things through, then you have to say, well, hold on, if we have all these extra workers lying around and we can pile up the capital, right? Well, at the moment, yeah, maybe wages will go down. But in time, we'll end up with like twice as many factories as we had before, because now, you know, we'll just accumulate capital and we'll be able to make money, we'll be able to make output by building new factories and hiring all these people that became unemployed. And at the end of that process, people's wages should be higher. They should be twice as high in this case, because each one of them, their marginal product will be twice as high. Because if they leave, now two machines will be unused instead of only one. You just have to be careful between, that example you gave about computers going twice as fast, like, I think if that's all that happens and nothing else changes, but computers get twice as fast, that's a case of capital augmenting technology, not labor augmenting technology. But it might often lead to a rearrangement of work processes or production processes that amounts to labor augmenting technology. But in itself, it's just capital augmenting technology, even if it makes workers better off, because now they can get more done. That's a capital complementing their work.
As having a bigger desk or making people who work on the desk better workers. I think I didn't put all the conditions, but yeah. So you already mentioned the wages and the capital rents, but another terms are capital share and labor share, which we were also say if they go down or up in our scenarios. And and there are certain assumptions that maybe we should not mention because they're like mathematical assumptions. We get that those two are sum to one. Do you want to explain a bit this formula?
Sure. So we said that each unit of capital got paid, its owner got paid the marginal product of capital each year, let's say, if we're thinking on a yearly scale. So that's that F sub K thing, is a marginal product of capital. And you multiply that by K, the amount of capital, and you get the total amount that all the investors took home that year. And then you divide that by F of AK, BL, you divide that by the by output, and you get the fraction of total output that got taken home as interest on investment. And then by the same logic, you think about F sub L, that's the marginal product of labor, that's the wage, multiply that by L, the amount of labor, that's the total amount that workers take home as wages, divide that by the output, and then you get the fraction of output that got taken home as wage. So if nothing's too screwy, those two things should add up to one, right? 100% of all of output got taken home either as capital rents or as wage.
And yeah, in practice, as you said, the labor share has been about 2/3.
Yeah.
And capital share. And that has been consistent for, the last centuries or something?
I think more.
More.
But, I mean, the data gets worse the further back you go, but at least for the last century or so. And in recent decades, the labor share has fallen a little bit. Now maybe it's not instead of being 67%, now maybe it's like 62%. In the US and UK. And people make a very big deal about this, blame it on Reagan or something. But I think the more striking fact is just that it's managed to stay so roughly constant for such a long time, even as the economy has grown a lot and industries have risen and fallen.
And maybe with AI, we'll be automating some part of this labor share, and it will shrink a bit. Which is, in all the scenarios you will consider further on, we'll see if the labor share stays constant or goes down a lot or even shrinks to zero. So I think another concept that is central to this literature review is elasticity of substitution. Maybe to understand that. So this took me a little sometimes to understand. So if someone has never, maybe I've never heard of elasticity in general for normal products, maybe you could start with that.
Sure. So the elasticity of one variable with respect to another variable is the percent that the first one rises when the other one rises by an increment. So if you're thinking about the price elasticity of demand for for Apple, what you're asking is when the price of apples rises by a tiny, tiny bit, if it rises by a penny,
apples. I don't really look at the prices of apples.
Well, but okay. But like you would if they got way higher, probably.
Oh, yeah.
If it was five times higher. And there's someone out there for whom the current price is five times higher than, the amount that it used to be and the amount that they would be willing to, casually buy them at. So there aren't going to be many people who stop buying apples or many apples they refrain from buying when the price goes up by a penny. But the question is, let's say like a pound of apples is $2. So and it goes up by a penny. So that's 0.5%. To what extent does the quantity of apples bought fall? Mm-hmm. If it falls by 0.5%, then the elasticity is 1. If it falls by 1%, the price elasticity of demand for apples is 2. That's the idea.
And yeah, could you give examples of products that are like clearly elastic, or where the price elasticity of demand is elastic and or inelastic? So do we have concrete real-world examples?
Sure. So how about some particular kind of apple? This is always a little arbitrary. Mm-hmm. What you count as a good and what you count as a category of good. But let's say we're just thinking about pink lady apples. Okay, I mean, I'd be very surprised if the price elasticity of demand for those were not well above 1. Because there's very close substitutes right on the shelf next to it.
Yeah, so people look, so when I guess one intuition for that is when the price elasticity of demand is high, then if the prices changes, people would just go for the substitute.
Yeah,
they don't really care about this pink pink lady app or something.
Right.
Sure. And yeah, how do you translate this concept to capital and labor, and this elasticity of substitution?
Yeah. So, a key thing to keep an eye on is the elasticity of substitution between capital and labor in production. And what that is let's say the quantity of one of the factors rises by a bit, how much, technically it's like, by how much does the usefulness of a bit more of that thing fall? Okay, so we've got our big factory with two pipes in, one pipe out. Let's say you have 1% more capital going in than you had yesterday. But you have the same amount of labor. Well, capital and labor, let's assume they're complements. Okay, they don't have to be gross complements, which is a stronger concept that I mentioned a minute ago. But they're just concepts in the sense that if you have a high capital to labor ratio, a lot of capital per unit of labor, then labor is more useful than if there's a low capital to labor ratio, and vice versa.
Just to have some clear visual for this, I don't know if you see in high elasticity, the upper left point, we have like high capital and low labor. And so this red line or pink lines are isoquant, which is the same amount of output. And so here in this point, if you, as you said, if we increase a little bit of the amount of capital by 0.1%, we would increase more if we increase capital, then you would decrease a little bit less labor, because the derivative is depending on the derivatives you get, how much you would need to change the other variables to get the same output.
That's another way of putting it. That's probably a better way of putting it, actually. I don't know. I mean, sure. Yeah. So if you have 1% or like 0.1% less capital, how much more labor do you need to fill in? And if the two factors are highly elastic, then you don't need that much extra labor. You can just sort of fill it in without too much trouble. But if there's low elasticity of substitution between them, then if you're running short on capital, you need lots and lots and lots of labor to make up for the difference, and vice versa.
I think that this will be more clear in the next slides, where we define in your paper you have epsilon is kind of elastic substitution, and then we have that can go from, I believe, 0 to plus infinity. And then you can divide, you can do epsilon minus 1 divided by epsilon, and this goes between up to 1. I don't know if you consider case of where it's like negative and infinite or something.
It can go down to negative infinity.
Do you have like any intuitions for this parameter rho or substitution parameter?
You don't need intuition for all that much. I think all you really need is to remember the following. So if rho is 1, that's the same as infinite elasticity of substitution, or perfect substitutability. And in that case, it doesn't matter which input you have. I mean, it's just you have humans and robots, side by side in the factory or whatever, cutting the hair. And you could just swap out one human for one robot, and like, or vice versa. Yeah, it's right. It's perfectly substitutable. It doesn't have to be one for one. There could be some constant ratio. Maybe the robot zips around twice as fast, so a robot's as good as two people. But they don't complement each other. It's not that if you have more robots around, it's better to have an extra person, or vice versa. So that's rho equals one. As rho goes down to negative infinity, you get to the case where they are perfect complements, and that's like left shoes and right shoes. If you have, you know, more of one than the other, then you you don't need any more of the one that you have in excess. And it, again, it can be at some ratio. So like bicycle frames and bicycle wheels, it's at a 2-to-1 ratio, but it's the same idea.
So yeah, the basic intuition with shoes is that you need both. So even if you don't have, even if you you know, have two left shoes and zero right shoes, you would still buy a right one because you need both.
That's right. And the marginal value of another left shoe to you is zero. It's not just low in that case. Mm-hmm. It's actually zero. Yeah. Now an interesting thing happens around rho equals zero in the middle there. Mm-hmm. If rho is greater than zero, even if it's not one, so the factors aren't perfect substitutes, they're substitutable enough that they are what's called gross substitutes. They're not gross complements, which is, if you know, a term I raised before. And what that means is that if you just have a fixed amount of one of the two things, labor, say, fixed amount of labor, but you pile up the capital, then output goes to infinity. You don't need labor. And likewise, if labor goes to infinity, but capital stays constant, output can go to infinity. If rho is less than zero, then you need both. Mm-hmm. And you might think of workers at their desks. You might be a bit more productive as your desk gets bigger and as your computer screen gets bigger and all of that. Mm-hmm. But as that goes to infinity, as the screen gets bigger, the desk gets bigger, your output just goes to an upper bound. And it might not be that much higher than the upper bound you have now. At least I find, you know, if I had a lot more capital to help me out, I don't know what I would even do with it after a while. It'd be maybe 10% more productive or something.
Yeah, I think those examples with rho equals one and minus one are very good to keep in mind. So with one, as you said, you get a perfect substitute, where you get this formula, pretty simple, where you have the sum of the two and you could either go for capital or either go for labor. And yeah, as you said, it corresponds to infinite elasticity. So you could just like be completely indifferent between the two products. And humans, like I put this diagram with like humans and chair and desk, because you would only be indifferent between those two if they had exactly the same prices.
Right, if they were perfectly substitutable. Yeah.
Yeah. If the price of human labor is too high, you would just go for desk. And yeah, the example with minus one is this example with shoes, where you have this fraction.
No, with shoes, that would be negative infinity.
Oh, sorry. That's a mistake, because when epsilon tends to zero, you go to minus infinity, yeah.
Yeah.
So
there's nothing special about the case of rho equals minus one. It seems like there should be, maybe, but there isn't. But I like using it as an illustration of the math, because it's kind of easier to wrap your head around than that funky thing you had a few slides back, where you have
So it's not perfect. So yeah, there's a mistake. This is the case where just rho equals minus one, and you get this simple example where you see when you increase capital, too much, then you only get it just the fraction tends to zero, and so you only the only thing that counts is labor.
That's right. I think so. This is this basic tendency, where as one of the factors goes to infinity, output just goes to being equal to how much you have of the other factor, or like linear in how much you have of the other factor. That tendency holds for any value of rho that's negative.
Right. So yeah, I think that's interesting to keep in mind this example of simple math for when rho is negative or when rho is positive, we have this sum. And yeah, and then there's this concept of endogenous versus exogenous growth. So yeah, I think one line of your paper is capital accumulation cannot be the primary force driving long-run growth. And then you go into like different cases for why it's not the case. Can you delve into that?
Sure. So empirically, it seems that at the moment, you know, before we've come up with AGI, capital and labor are gross complements. So rho is negative. And what that means is that you couldn't sustain growth just by piling up the capital. Because it's like, you know, people sitting at a desk and the desk gets ever bigger and you have ever more pens in the drawer. And like, you know, what do you do with it? So as we piled up the capital, we would just get output going to an upper bound. And that would be proportional to the number of people. So that's that Y goes to BL thing you have. And another thing that would happen is that the capital share would fall to zero, because it would be like, this is why the elasticity of substitution point is sort of relevant. The thought is, so as the number of desks grows and grows, by 1%, then another percent, then another percent, what happens to the marginal product of an inch of desk space? It falls. But how fast does it fall? Well, if rho is less than zero, that is, if the elasticity is less than one, the marginal product falls by more than a percent every time. Okay? So you have 1% more desks, but the rent that they take, that each desk lender gets, falls by more than a percent.
Okay.
And so that means that the amount they're all getting collectively is shrinking, even as the amount of desks is rising. And the capital...
So they stop investing at that point.
Yeah, I mean, they probably stopped investing, but if they didn't, just theoretically, if they, for some reason, just kept on building desks and lending them out at ever less, then the capital share would go to zero, right? Because you know, for every percent extra desks you have less than a... The amount per desk falls by more than a percent.
Okay, and yeah... Probably people would also like with this increase of debt, they would also like have to have more human labor, and so this human labor would represent more of this share of output.
Yeah, right. So that's another thing happening. I mean, it wouldn't matter after a while, but at least for a while, human labor would be getting more productive, and that would raise the wages. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's why like just investing more capital couldn't sustain growth in the long term.
It couldn't sustain growth, and it would lead to a capital share falling to zero. But historically, we've observed constant capital share, and we have seen growth. So, so capital accumulation can't be what's going on.
Yeah, there's some contradiction with empirical facts.
Yeah, and not in isolation.
Yeah. And then there's when we consider negative rho, so elasticity less than one, this is in your scenario, like those conditions. Yeah, can you explain a little bit like those this scenario and how to get long-run growth?
Sure. The way to get long-run growth in output per capita when rho is negative, that is when labor and capital are gross complements, is to is to have labor augmenting technology. That's the only way to do it. And the reason is that to get growth in output, not per capita, but just output period, you need growth in two things. First is either capital or capital augmenting technology. Mm-hmm. Right? You need more AK.
Yep.
The second thing you need is more BL. Right? You need more effective labor, as it's called. Yep. But so when it comes to growing the stock of effective capital, it doesn't matter whether that comes in the form of more actual capital or more capital augmenting technology. Either one is fine. But when it comes to growing the pool of effective labor, that can't come from just growing the number of people, because then you just have more mouths to feed. If you want more output per person, you mm-hmm. need growth in B, that yep. is labor augmenting technology. And so that's the first step. You need B growing at some rate.
And yeah, so one thing important about, we talked a lot of product output and GDP, but we never talked about the distinction between people consuming this GDP and or people investing more. So maybe you could explain that as well.
Sure. So, we talked about all the final goods that came out the pipe at the end of the factory. Mm-hmm. That's GDP. And I think I might have sloppily said, we're just talking about the consumption goods.
Yeah.
But I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry. I should have said the final goods. And sometimes it's not clear what counts as the final good. It's true. Like with the eggs and the cake, right? You know, is the cake the final good, or is the egg the final good that you bring home and bake mm-hmm. a cake out of? Well, in the same way, it's a little unclear what's the final good when what you're making is a widget that's then used next year in a factory to make mm-hmm. more goods. But anyway, let's put that aside and say, okay, we're just looking at all the final goods produced this year. That's GDP. That includes haircuts and cars, but it also includes light bulbs, which are not used at home, but are used in a factory to, light the place up and let workers mm-hmm. work on cars for next year. So that's GDP. Now, remember, we need two things growing to get growth in output per capita, right? We need growth in B and we need growth in AK. Now, let's say A is fixed. So there's no capital augmenting technology growth. Mm-hmm. How is K going to grow? Well, that's what's called saving. That's not consuming all of mm-hmm. the output of the factory, not consuming all of GDP, but using some of it to make more stuff next year or whatever in the future. So using the light bulbs to light up the factory and not the home.
Or you could just sell your stuff, sell what you produce, and then like buy more things with the money you make from selling.
Well, yeah, but let's not think about we're thinking about the economy as a whole.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. like if it's the whole world, then there's no one to buy or to sell to.
Right.
You're just thinking about, yeah. So if the savings rate is high enough, then growth in K will be enough to keep up with that growth in B, that GB. So
right.
if B is growing at 2% a year and the savings rate is high enough, then you'll have both those inputs to the big factory of the economy, the metaphorical factory, growing at 2% a year, and output will also be growing at 2% a year. If the savings rate isn't high enough, then we'll be constrained by capital eventually, and output will be slower.
Right. Yeah, and at this point, you show that output, capital grow at the same rate as the labor augmenting technology B, and you get as well wages and capital rents per person growing. That would sustain long-term growth. You made a distinction between endogenous growth and exogenous growth. Could you maybe explain the distinction?
Sure. So as noted, we need growth in B, in labor augmenting technology, to get growth in output per capita like we've observed and hope to keep getting. Where does that growth come from? Well, if you're not really going to model it, but you're just going to say, well, somehow B grows at 2% a year, and we'll think about the rest of the economy, assuming that that happens. That's called exogenous growth. But if we're going to actually model where that growth in B comes from, we call it endogenous growth. And there's a certain class of models that I think is most plausible, sometimes called semi-endogenous growth models, where growth comes from scientific research, but it comes from, or applied R&D, more kind of further down the pipeline. But in any event, it comes from people working. But you need growth in the number of scientists to maintain growth in output. You can't just have a constant number of scientists leading to exponential growth in output. You need growth in the scientists. And where does growth in scientists come from? Population growth and growth in education. We're not going to model that. We're just going to say that comes out of the sky. So that's why it's called semi-endogenous. But it's more like endogenous than like exogenous. You're at least kind of explaining.
Yeah. So endogenous is comes from inside, whereas exogenous is from outside.
Basically, yeah.
And yeah, without going too much into the math, but if you have this growth in B that comes from scientists that are a fraction of the labor force that work on maybe like more labor augmenting technology, from this paper we mentioned, our idea is getting harder to find. We can see that sometimes scientists can collaborate and do great stuff and be complementary, or they can step on toes and. You need to invest more in research to get more done. Is that the intuition between the parameter lambda or in this model?
Yeah, lambda ends up not mattering much for the model. But lambda equal to 1 would mean that if you double the number of scientists at a given time, you double the rate at which they come up with increases to B, right? Increases in labor augmented technology. And if lambda is greater than 1, then the relationship between number of scientists at a given time and advances in B is more than linear. Doubling the number of scientists leads to more than a doubling in the speed at which they crank out the increases to labor augmented technology. And if lambda is less than 1, it's the other way. Doubling the number of scientists less than doubles there. Contribution.
Yeah, intuitively we would think that lambda is inferior to 1, right? It's we have diminishing returns in having more scientists or having more labor in science.
I think that is what we tend to observe, though. I don't know if that's because of duplicated work or just because you're going to choose the best, if you're only going to have a few scientists, if there's only a little bit of research funding, it'll be the best ones. And then as you dip ever deeper into the dregs, you might double the number of scientists, but you won't double the number of IQ points.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess the other kind of parameter for this model is kind of this power to this labor augmenting technology, and this parameter phi, where depending on where it is, you can either have something that stops the growth in labor augmenting technology, or leads to type one or two singularities. I have a hard time like kind of understanding this parameter. What's the intuition behind it? And there's also like you mentioned that is empirically at -2.1, or at least like that's one estimate.
Yeah.
So do you agree with that estimate if you remember it, or
right?
Can you explain a bit what's the number?
Yeah. So I'll explain what it signifies and then comment on it. I call it the research feedback parameter. Mm-hmm. If it's equal to one, then we have purely endogenous growth in the sense that we don't need any increase to the number of, let's call them scientists, to maintain constant exponential growth in B, labor augmented technology. So that's positive research feedback. What's going on is, sorry, I should have explained this first. So maybe if you can put this.
Sure, yeah.
Right. If phi is positive, we have positive research feedback, meaning that the inventions we've already come up with help us in developing further inventions, further advances in labor augmenting technology. So we have, we have computers, and those help us in our projects to develop the next big thing after computing. If phi is negative, then that might still be true, right? Inventions in the past help us with further technological advancement. But there's this other factor which outweighs it, and it's the fishing out effect. It's that given that we've already invented something as great as a computer, it's harder to invent the next thing because the next thing is even more complicated. And that wins out. Even though we have computers, we move more slowly with the same number of scientists because things have gotten so much harder. And so if phi is negative, with a constant number of scientists, things just get harder and harder. And the level of technology rises to an upper bound, then it gets stuck. What you need to maintain growth, with phi being negative, is you need to sustain growth in the number of scientists. As you mentioned, there's a paper from, it was a few years in the making, but just published last year, called Our Idea is Getting Harder to Find, which tries to estimate phi and finds that phi is quite negative.
But you need to invest much more money or people, more labor to get this new advances in Moore's Law or other scientific adventures.
Yeah. I mean, the key issue is that you need more people. If you just needed more capital, then, more money that just bought capital, equipment, then actually you could sustain growth and output per person, even without the scientists multiplying, because you could just pile up the factories that do the science. And the real issue is that you need growth in labor input, but we're trying to get growth in output per capita. So
So I think now at this point we kind of have a idea of like this parameter phi, this research feedback. Maybe we can like go over more generally, like the different kind of scenarios you draw down the line.
Well, you asked what I thought of the estimate for my RIDS.
Oh, sorry.
And, it's fine. I think, so what they do is they sort of look at a bunch of different industries and estimate phi in those industries. But actually, it varies a lot across industries, and it's just for the economy as a whole that it seems like it's negative two. And if I remember right, the only industry in which it's positive is actually in Moore's law. So I'd forgotten about this when, maybe there's two, but anyway, one of them is in Moore's law. So it seems that, you know, the better computers we have with the faster chips help us make faster chips by more than it gets harder to make faster chips, because we've picked the low hanging fruit. And that seems very significant, especially when we're trying to make projections, because if like a kind of growing fraction of the economy is being done by computers or whatever, then maybe the positive feedback loop part of it will end up taking over. And so it's sort of a mistake to think that the composition will be the same. And so you have this average negative two.
Right.
That's constant into the future.
So for AI and Moore's law, it's positive. And for like other scientific endeavors, it's negative. And in the average term, like negative, doesn't mean that we couldn't get something, a labor of augmented technology growing, because most of it would come from AI or something.
Yeah, exactly. And this is something I hadn't really paid attention to when I talked about this on Hear This Idea, or I haven't really thought about too much until recently. But I mean, it's only slightly positive, and it's zero is very much in the error bars. So I think more research on actually confirming that there is this area of positive research feedback would be valuable, and picking it apart, right? Because it might be that it's negative in the domain of AI, even though it's positive in the domain of like just fitting more transistors on a chip.
Right.
And so, yeah, that's all I have to say about that.
Cool. Yeah, I think we can just skip the next one and just go on the like different scenarios. So the HS means high substitutability PS perfect one. So those are like the different values for rho are substitutability parameter. And then I think plus plus is when it increases in a significant way. So not the type one, but yeah, a significant increase. And the labor share could go to a constant C or to zero. And yet I is a singularity type one.
Yeah. Right. So
yeah, what's the intuition between like those kind of three scenarios?
Okay. Well, we skipped over the first scenario where we talked about different kinds of consumption goods, right? That was on the previous slide, which we skipped. And I think it is maybe a bit of a digression, so I won't say anything about the first line. In the second line, we're dealing with a model in which you have that factory of the economy with the two pipes in and the one pipe out. But now, instead of rho being negative, as it is now and has been, it's positive. And it could be between zero and one, or it could be one. But either way, here's what's going to happen. The growth rate is going to accelerate. Or the growth rate is going it's going to rise. Because now, growth isn't bottlenecked by growth in B anymore, right? Once rho is positive, you don't need growth in AK and growth in BL. You just need growth in one of the two. could be either one.
Mm-hmm.
And in particular, it could just be growth in K.
Yeah.
So if you just have a high enough savings rate, then it'll, then you could have a growth rate. I mean, just, you know, like if A equals one, which actually seems about reasonable right now, then let's say we save 12% of our output every year, then what's the growth rate going to be? It's just going to be 12% in the long run.
Yeah, because we're just saving all that and invest that in capital.
Yeah. So it's just 12% more every year. What happens to the human labor share, or the labor share? It goes to zero because the number of effective humans is staying the same, but you have this capital that can... Massive pile of capital that is substitutable for the labor. So it's just, you know, more and more robots, same number of people. So
mm-hmm.
the fraction of payment going to the people is just going to zero. What happens to wages? Well, in this case, actually, it depends on whether labor and capital are perfectly substitutable
mm-hmm.
or just highly substitutable. If they're perfectly substitutable, then wages should just stay the same. So wage growth should just stop if there's mm-hmm. no labor augmenting technology. And if there is labor augmenting technology, well, the wage should just keep on rising at the rate of labor augmenting technology growth. Because you have the robots and workers side by side, and they're very substitutable, or if they're perfectly substitutable, and so the explosion in the number of robots doesn't affect the productivity of the people beside them. So their productivity stays the same, wage stays the same, unless they get more productive, in which case the wage rises. If labor and capital only become highly substitutable, though, then because you have this explosion in the growth rate, because saving is enough for growth, right? So the growth rate mm-hmm. rises to like 12% right. or 20% or whatever. You also have an explosion in the number of robots or the amount of capital that's substituting for labor, however it's doing it. And with rho less than one, even if it's still positive, okay, because we're insisting on its high substitutability, but with rho less than one, having more of that capital around raises the marginal productivity of labor. Does that make sense? So you have wages rising, and the wage growth rate rises.
Yeah. So it's if you cannot. It's a distinction between perfect substitutability and still substitutability but not perfect. And depending on that parameter, you would have either the human wages. So we're talking about the second line, right?
Yeah.
But if it's not perfect, then you would have the wages growing. I guess the more interesting kind of scenario is the third line, where you have both wages and growth going at, you know, on a time point singularity. So for me, it's like kind of hard to understand how would a human behave with like an exponential growth, an exponential wage. Like what would they buy? What would they do in this scenario?
It would have to be super exponential, but we already have exponentially growing wages.
Right. Super exponential. So that if the growth rate of wages grow exponentially.
Yeah. It is hard to imagine, though I think it would have been hard to imagine in the past, you know, like someone in medieval times might have said, what would we do with like $1 million to spend every year or something on ourselves? Mm-hmm. Where we can have a big castle, but then what? A bigger castle? Like, come on. But yeah, you know, as time goes on and as people get richer, new products are developed. I mean, this gets back to something we were talking about before, but new products get developed, which are, you know, people enjoy buying or spending their money on. I don't know what the products of the future will be, but I wouldn't put it past people to come up with ways to waste a lot of money, or spend a lot of money.
So, maybe I think it's interesting to just like skip. I think we got the intuition for kind of this imperfect substitute scenario. I think it's interesting to go over, if you talk about your medieval guy, at some point the parameter of land was very important. So I think in this model, I think it's adapted from Hanson, a paper from Robin Anton.
Yeah.
And you have this parameter of land, and you also have robotics and a fixed amount of humans. So I find this very interesting. Could you maybe explain a bit?
Sure. So in the third line from the previous slide, we got a type one singularity because we had capital augmenting technology growing exponentially. At the same time, capital was growing exponentially.
Right.
So you have this exponential thing growing exponentially.
Mm-hmm.
And capital alone is enough for growth. Here, we're looking at a different model in which human labor and capital are perfectly substitutable, in which you can have capital augmenting technology growing, and you can have capital growing, but you don't have a singularity. You just have a boost to the growth rate. And the thing that's different about this model is that now labor and capital aren't the only two factors of production. You have a third thing, which you sort of need as well, and that's land. The amount of land is fixed. And
is the fixed amount of land like an important consideration? Like, do you think is a reasonable assumption for, you know, like we're doomed to stay on this planet and we cannot build like gigantic buildings, so we have this fixed amount of land? Or do you think is you can be relaxed and you can like think about making buildings with more land in the building and you know, conquering new planets or something?
I don't know whether we'll ever be able to colonize space. It seems very hard, but at the same time, you know, we've just we went over the course of a century from horses and buggies to putting people on the moon. So to maintain the singularity, you would need like exponential growth I don't know if that's true. Would you need exponential growth in land?
Maybe
I haven't thought about this.
Maybe we can ask Robin Hanson.
Well, no, I mean, I can. So this isn't Hanson's model, actually. I sort of adapted it from Hanson's paper.
Mm-hmm.
But Hanson just sort of got rid of the singularity by making output less than, by making output decreasing returns to scale in labor and capital. Whereas before, we didn't talk about this, but the other models assumed constant returns to scale in labor and capital. So the idea there is if you just double the number of factories and the number of workers working at them, what happens to output? Well, it just doubles, right? That kind of makes sense. But no, because we forgot about the land. If we just had twice as many factories and twice as many people, but the same amount of land, then you'd have to start putting the factories on land that wasn't so suitable for a factory. And output wouldn't double. It would rise by a bit less. And that becomes more and more of a problem as the ratio between the amount of land and the amount of other stuff, capital and labor, as that falls. But But anyway, so Hansen just made output decreasing returns in labor and capital. He didn't specify land. So he just had PAK to the A times that other thing to the B, where A plus B is less than one. And I just spelled that out a bit more by introducing land and having them add up to one again, having the exponents add up to one, which is more conventional.
Yeah, I think it makes sense for me.
Cool. But I was going to say, if we colonized space, then even in the best case scenario, land would only grow cubically, right? Because it'd be like a sphere centered at the Earth going outward.
We need exponentially.
So I don't think that would be enough for a singularity, in practice. But anyway, I mean, again, that would be kind of probably pushing the model beyond its intended bound.
I guess if you really want to push it, you could say that as you want, you know, if you want to test. Like what you need is not land, is like kind of resources and energy, like kind of the bottleneck of most physical processes. And to get energy, you could do like a Dyson sphere or something on the sun, and maybe in the next centuries or thousands of years, you would have like even subtler ways of using energy and improving the rate of creating energy.
Though there is that limit of just like perfect efficiency.
Yeah. So. So here I think what I understand of this model is like when you instead of considering labor augmenting technology, we have this fixed human labor, and then we can just like spend our capital to buy more labor directly. So that's the like point. That's the fraction 1 minus p that we spend on capital that can be used into labor. And so that that's like a perfect substitution, as we see, is like an addition between those two, and so we can just like spend a lot of capital and our to get more growth, and then we just invest more in capital. Is that the basic conclusion?
Yeah, that's right. Though again, in this model, labor and capital together are not enough for growth. I mean, they're enough. It's sort of right on the edge. I mentioned what happens if rho is positive, what happens if rho is negative. Also, in this case, rho is zero, exactly. And what that ends up meaning is that whereas you would otherwise have a type 1 singularity with capital augmenting technology growth and perfect substitutability between labor and capital, here you just get a growth rate increase.
Okay.
It's sort of a funny little edge case, but when rho equals zero, then it sort of bumps down a singularity to a growth rate increase.
Okay. Still interesting. I think it's an interesting equation to think about. I think the one we get after is the different scenarios. I'm not sure if it is from this equation. We see Anson. Yeah. I guess we get like those different scenarios. I'm not sure how much we should delve into all of them, or if there's like one that is particularly interesting to you from those.
I don't know. I mean, yeah, we were just talking about the one on the second line. I guess earlier we were effectively talking about the previous line. We talked about the perfect substitutability in production. There's no land constraint. And you have capital augmenting tech growth, right? You get human wages stagnate, and you get that.
Go ahead. If we have no land, then we have type one singularity in growth, and wages
are infinite land. You know, if we have no land constraint,
if you have no land constraint, infinite land.
And then for the third line, quickly, the difference here is that instead of having capital augmenting technology growth on the whole, we only have technology growth in the capital that complements labor. So we only have ways to use metal more efficiently in the machines that the robots use in the factory, the robots or the humans. But when it comes to the robots, we can pile up the robots, but we don't get more efficient at making them, and they don't get more productive.
Okay.
In that scenario, human wages don't fall to zero, because you have kind of two things balancing each other out. One is that we can make more and more robots, right, which are competing with workers. But on the other hand, we have more and more equipment for these robots and workers to use, which raises workers' wages. So the robots lower the workers' wages, but the equipment that gets more efficient raises them, and those cancel out, and the wages just stagnate.
I think that's an important distinction. Robots are the capital that can. How do you distinguish equipment from robotics? So robotics can help for human labor, whereas equipment is just to help humans and cannot substitute completely for them.
Robots do labor, and equipment complements labor.
Interesting. You're talking about what would happen if robots could, do the work to get more robots. So you're pointing at somehow the self-improving robots in this model.
They're not self-improving in this case. They're just self-replicating. In the model you have on the slide.
Yeah.
And yeah, I think the main contribution of this model, this is the Mukherjee and Ray model, is to point out that all the other models we've talked about so far let robots build, everything, right? So they're substituting for labor, whatever we're trying to make. But the important thing is sort of not whether they can do everything, but whether they can make other robots. The way I should put it is, even if they can do everything else, as long as humans remain necessary in making robots, then humans will still maintain a positive labor share, right? And so we can think about the implications of substitutability in robotics production in isolation instead of in the economy as a whole. I don't know. I don't think this adds all that much, to be honest, but it's worth clarifying that.
What doesn't add to all that much? These equations, or?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the question is, how can people maintain a positive labor share? If that's your question, right? How can people remain necessary for production? Well, what matters is people being necessary for the production of something that is necessary,
mm-hmm.
or something that people want and won't just use robots to do instead. And that can be through. I mean, as lots of people have noticed, that there are a lot of jobs that we prefer done by humans. So some artisanal bread or artwork or care home work, there might just be some kinds of things we want humans to do. And if we want it enough, we might use our newfound wealth with all the, all the growth that AI brings to just hire lots and lots of people to give us massages and serve us in care homes and make us artisanal bread. And everyone might end up doing that, and you have a positive labor share or growing wages or whatever it is that you're keeping an eye on, whatever variable. One of the ways that people could remain necessary is by making robots if people are necessary for the creation of robots. But But I don't think that's all that interesting. It's just a specific case of a more general observation that we already knew about.
Yeah, okay. So you're saying essentially that, yeah, if you want to keep humans having good wages and having a substantial fraction of the labor share, we should have humans doing something useful, and then they could be paid by, you know, this amount of growth we have, we could give it back to the humans doing something useful. And the humans doing robotics is a special case of this.
Yeah, if humans are necessary
for doing robotics.
Yeah.
And they're are at least as useful as robots or complementary. I think, so yeah, I guess if this model is not very interesting, for me, one thing that's happened in the past, I think this year, was this company, OpenAI, releasing something that enables humans to generate code with their model. So you can just like start coding and it will autocomplete your code with their model directly. And yeah, I've used it a lot, and every time I use it, it generates useful code that I can read and reuse myself. And yeah, if you think about, you know, the system developers using this, even OpenAI developers, employees, plus the model, when we write more code using their model, we can then use this code to improve this robot or this AI software. And so we get in a sort of closed loop where humans are kind of useful, but they're not the only part that's useful for making code. Now, yeah, AI is also accelerating this.
Yeah, but that was already true before, right? We had capital helping out with the process of improving AI. What will really be the qualitative shift will be when you don't need the human in the loop, right? When it can just work on itself without any human.
And yeah, if you make the human faster, if you make the human writing software or AI code faster by helping him write more code with AI, would it affect, do you think intuitively it will like lead to faster growth and like a type one singularity, or in your view, it doesn't really change that much in your models?
Again, you keep calling them mine. They're not mine.
Oh, sorry. in the models, fine. In the literature review.
I just, you know, on the off chance any of them are listening, I'm not claiming any credit. Yeah, okay. So that is an interesting thought. That would be different from what I said. So what I said was that would just be like capital. You know, that's we already have capital complementing people doing stuff. But this would be a case in which capital is not substituting for labor, but making labor augmenting technology grow, right? So the human's getting more productive. One programmer can do what it used to take two programmers to do, and I think the model, yeah.
I think this could go into labor augmenting technology. If you're coding faster, you effectively
better worker. So this maybe moves to the next slide.
I think the next ones are essentially different scenarios. I don't know how much we want to go into like this 10 different scenarios or something. What do you think? I could cut this out.
I don't know. I mean, so these two lines right here are about the thing we just talked about, right? Okay. About substitutability in robotics production in particular. I don't have much more to say about them than I already said.
Okay.
But for later slides, I don't know.
Yeah, then there's the impacts on savings. Oh, sorry, how savings can have an impact on growth as well.
Yeah, so So this is also a little bit tangential, but maybe worth noting briefly. So in a world where capital can substitute for labor well enough, so if rho is greater than zero, the savings rate can affect the growth rate. Remember before, where labor and capital were gross complements, where rho is negative, basically what drove growth in output per capita was growth in B. And if the savings rate is too low, then growth is bottlenecked. But as long as the saving rate is enough to keep up with growth in B, then further saving doesn't increase the growth rate. But once rho is greater than zero, then you can just pile up capital and get more and more output. So increasing the savings rate does increase the growth rate. And it could be that something about AI causes people to save more or save less than they were saving before. And there's a lot of stories you could tell as to how that would happen. And there are two of them that people have written papers about. But there's in principle, you can imagine 1,000 ways that AI would affect the savings rate. And it would then affect the growth rate if rho is greater than zero.
And yeah, when we mean saving, it's not like people literally putting money on their bank account, or it's more like people investing in investing in SAP 500 or companies, right?
Yeah, that's right.
It's like an investment.
It has to be investment. People use the term savings rate, but more accurately would be investment. The more accurate thing to say would be investment rate.
Interesting. And then there's this whole, I think this literature review as an entire part on task-based models for good productions. Yeah, could you explain briefly what that is?
Sure. So as we mentioned a while back, the growth rate increase that we've been benefiting from since the Industrial Revolution, I think can be pretty well thought of as capital doing ever more tasks that labor used to have to do. So, you know, the steam engine or whatever, you know, we now can make machines that do things that people used to do. And at first glance, that sounds like a very different model of what's been going on with growth than the model we were talking about before, in which you have labor augmenting technology and capital augmenting technology. And there's not tasks in that model. You just have the factory with two pipes in, one pipe out. And remember, capital augmenting technology was meant you could use less steel for the cars. And maybe labor augmenting technology is one person figures out a technique to operate two machines at once. But where's the substitute? You know, where's the task replacement? You know, it's not clear. Mm-hmm. But it turns out a paper from just, I think, 2 years ago shows, this is Aguillon, Jones, and Jones, that the two are basically equivalent. So if rho is negative, if capital and labor are gross complements, then you can, basically, if you imagine that what's going on inside the factory is a whole sequence of tasks, some of which you can use labor. Some of which you can use capital for, and the rest of which you have to use labor for, then as tasks get automated, that ends up functioning like labor augmenting technology. And the way it works is, I think, pretty interesting. So it's like, let's say we start out with 40% of the tasks being done by capital and the other 60% being done by labor, because we've only automated the first 40% so far. Mm-hmm. then on average, each person sort of has to spread their work across six, let's say it's 100 tasks. They spread it across 60 tasks.
That are not automated.
Because they're not automated, yeah. Right. And so for every person you add into the person pipe of the big factory of the economy, output only increases by a little bit because that person has to spread their work across a lot of tasks. Mm. I mean, in practice, they would specialize, but on average, right. you understand that each person, in effect, is spreading their labor across a lot of tasks, and you just have a little bit of capital on the side doing the other 40 tasks, and output only goes up a little. But then let's say you automate half of those 60 tasks. So now only 30 tasks are done by labor. Now each person in effect can be responsible for twice as much output as before, because they only need to spread their work across half as many tasks, yeah. And the capital takes care of the rest. So it's sort of like doubling B. You see that?
Yeah, I get the intuition, yeah.
Yeah. And you can have this exponential growth in B that we've observed just by having this constant fall in the number of remaining non-automated tasks. So that goes to zero. The number of tasks you need labor for goes to zero, mm-hmm. asymptotically. But you never quite get there. So okay. You always need people for some little bit at the end. And that ends up kind of being the same as growth in B. So anyway, so you have all these task-based models of AI, as they're called. And if you just introduce a task-based model to a model with growth in B separately, so you have automation and people getting more productive at each task, then that increases the growth rate. And it shouldn't change anything about the labor share. So what does that mean for wages? Well, if the growth rate rises,
yeah,
and the fraction going to labor stays the same, mm-hmm. then wages have to rise.
Yeah.
So those are those two scenarios in the middle there. But if you kind of automate everything, if you automate all the tasks, or if you kind of shake things up, yeah, more deeply, then you can get a singularity rather than just more growth.
Yeah, and that's when growth and wages grows super exponentially, and we have a singularity at that point. I think it's interesting that we can make a parallel with task-based models and the other ones. I haven't looked too much into AI and technology production.
Right. Well, I think this is kind of the most interesting part of it.
Okay, so go for it. Really go for it.
You can really get to self-improving technology.
Okay, go for it. Yeah, I'm down to learn more.
Sure. I mean, as we can see, there are a lot of different models here, but mm-hmm. here's where we're finally seeing some twos. You know, some type two singularity.
Oh, yeah.
And,
infinite output, infinite time.
Yeah, finite time. And what's going on there is, remember those semi-endogenous models from before, where you need growth in the number of scientists to maintain mm-hmm. growth and yep. output. Well, if you have like robot scientists, basically, then you can get this feedback loop where you have super exponential growth in scientists, leading to super exponential growth in technology. But if the technology is capital augmenting and the scientists are made of capital. That means effectively you have mm-hmm. more scientists next year.
Nothing brewing, yeah.
And that's the right. That's the real the real crazy feedback loop that could lead to an AI singularity.
And I believe people like to talk about scientists as something very abstract that is hard to automate because, you know, the scientist walks into a bar, has a wife, and does a bunch of human things. But if you just like replace like science in AI with like people coding things and you know, slapping their fingers on computers and getting more feedback from what they do. And I feel like those robot scientists could just be... AI generating code, AI generating AI code is already, for me, a robot scientist in some sense.
Sure. Because... I mean, we need more than computers at the moment to actually develop products and stuff and like better understandings of the world. So I think you're frozen.
Oh, sorry.
No, you're there. You're not there.
Yeah. So, it depends on exactly where what we're focusing on. If we're talking only about, you know, creating, you know, products that can be consumed, yes, we need humans to do the caring, the cooking, and all the things. But if we're only talking about production of, you know, software, The AI can like the AI and the human are in a loop where the AI now can like suggest code for the human to read, and the human then like understands it and accept or not the code to generate it. And I don't see much more than this, like two things, like human accepting or not accepting, and the AI suggesting more code.
But that's if we're just making code.
Yeah. You don't need much more than code to create an AI. Yeah, we need the servers and the electronics and the networking behind it.
No. Yeah, sure. But I mean, that's all for AI getting better and better
mm-hmm.
at being AI.
Exactly.
But what I'm saying is, one thing that you need to have an explosion in scientists, more broadly speaking, is you need systems. I keep calling them robots, but whatever. You need systems that can do all of the things we call R&D, not just AI R&D. We ultimately need a system that can replace human contributions to mm-hmm. developing new kinds of potato chips and mm-hmm. beds, you know, mattresses and
so,
cars and whatever.
I think the counter argument to that is what we're actually interested is like having AIs that can automate human intelligence. And so as long as we have something that's as general as a human and can like think and communicate with humans and have like strategize and those things, then I believe that, you know, if we only have code that self-replicates and becomes better code until it reaches this like human level intelligence, at this point it can just like ask humans to do stuff for him or manipulate humans to do stuff for him. And so, yeah, you don't really need more food or human science, because now the AI can do whatever it wants by just sending requests or orders to other parts of the world.
But I mean, if there's only so many people, and if people actually remain necessary, then
it wouldn't be enough to sustain it wouldn't be enough to sustain an exponential growth. Yeah. Okay, I get you.
But also, I think it's worth remembering that intelligence isn't the only input to, at least, unless you define intelligence more broadly than we naturally do, intelligence isn't the only input to R&D. When coming up with new products, for instance, having an intimate understanding of human preferences strikes me as an important, an important factor that that machines probably won't have for a long time, or maybe a short time, but it'll be one of the latter things to for it to beat us up. You might have a friend who's very smart, smarter than you, but doesn't know your preferences as well as you do. And likewise, I think we could have an AI that's sort of more intelligent than any human being in every sort of on every dimension we would call intelligence, but doesn't really have quite as sophisticated and intuitive understanding of what product will really tickle our fancy.
And you would need that to kind of sell this product to humans?
No, just to think of the product in the first place.
Okay.
This is going to be a really good one. No one's going to like that.
Okay.
I'm just saying, to really, really replace people for everything, you don't. We casually use the term artificial intelligence, but we're not just about intelligence, and you would need artificial arms as well, and we're familiar with that problem. The difficulty of building robots with as much dexterity as mm-hmm. people have, that's not the same as intelligence. Just another thing is this like intimate understanding of human preferences, which is, intelligence can help you get that, but it's not identical to intelligence.
Yeah, so I think there's like this definition of intelligence as more closer to like what humans call IQ and ability to like think in like abstract and logical ways, and then there's like this more general definition from I think used by Bostrom in his book Super Intelligence as the ability to achieve one's goals, where if you don't have robotic arms, if you don't have like human arms and as not with as much dexterity, and you're not able to achieve one goal, then you're like considered less smart than someone else. In a common sense, you that doesn't count as common sense intelligence.
Yeah, I think that's right. We don't think of Stephen Hawking as less intelligent because he was stuck in a wheelchair. If anything, that made him seem more intelligent. But ability to achieve your goals. I think that's even if a machine had all of the things we conventionally call intelligence and had arms and was like much better than a person achieving their goals, whether people will use it to replace all their human, scientists and developers depends on whether it's better than a human at achieving the robot owner's goals. And the robot owner's goals might be to come up with better, better potato chips, and the robot might not know.
Okay, so I guess, it doesn't really... You can have something that is like intelligent or able to do stuff in the abstract, but you need to have humans that are actually interested in using the thing for other humans' products or preferences. That's interesting.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I think that's sometimes overlooked, and mm-hmm. that's not relevant if you're Bostrom and you're writing about superintelligence. You're not even thinking about a scenario in which people continue to own and fully control what these things do and just decide to use them for this and not for that. We're thinking about like the danger that comes with the robot that can like have scary goals and execute on mm-hmm. them. And for that, all you care about is that it's smart and it has arms. You don't care about whether it knows what kind of potato chips people like. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about what effect it will have on the growth rate in a scenario where it stays under control. Then you have to think about this other this other thing as well.
So I think that's a perfect transition to the conclusion of this whole presentation, where I think at the end of your literature review, you mentioned or maybe it's like in this Hear This Idea podcast, that economists don't really consider long-term growth increases, and they mostly consider that, it will maybe increase by a few percent. But they don't consider dramatic increases, let apart like singularities or something. Do you get the impression that like there's more and more paper about that, and economists are starting to consider those scenarios, or are you the only one that? Not the only one, because you've done a literature review but yeah, are there more papers being written about this?
I don't think so. I kind of hope so. When I wrote this thing, I saw a number of papers that considered these singularitarian scenarios.
Mm-hmm.
But I was actually at a little online conference, not a little, pretty big, but online conference on the econ of AI last week.
Wow.
Hosted by the NBER, the National Bureau of Economic Research. And Anton Koronek,
mm-hmm.
my co-author for the Literature yep. Review, did a survey of all of us there on questions like what we thought would happen to the growth rate given AGI and, you know, and so on. And only a small number of people thought there was any more than like a 1% chance, let alone like a 10% chance that AGI would lead to any kind of singularity. And people's projections about the growth rate over the next century, or I think, yeah, next century was what we were asked about, were very boring. People thought it was almost certainly going to stay around 2% a year or something.
What was the population? What were there, like, singularitarians, or did you have more traditional economists?
It was entirely traditional economists.
Okay. Okay, and yeah, what do you think? Are you part of the 1%, or do you have a more nuanced opinion?
No, yeah, I mean, I think conditional on AGI, the chance of a singularity is, more than 10%. I don't think it's like, I don't think it's guaranteed. I forget what number I put down, but I've sort of wavered on this, but maybe I think there's like a 1 in 4 chance of it or something.
Okay, so 25%.
It's
a bit unwavy. We don't have any quantitative estimates on that. So I guess more kind of more like a gut feeling. I guess one thing that make me laugh at your conclusion of the literature review is you mentioned that as long as humans are still a little bit useful for work, they could just, you know, stop working and go on strike and then receive a lot of human labor. A lot of capital, a lot of wages. And or we could have things where you can just like invest more capital and get like self-improving robots. Do you think like any of those two scenarios might happen in your lifetime? Humans going on strike or like self-improving robots?
So humans going on strike certainly
for is happen in my lifetime. Against robots,
Sure. I don't know. I mean, if you imagine an Amazon packing facility, in which the workers aren't being overseen by a human manager, but by a computer or by a camera that has some AI ability to see how hard they're working. I can totally see the workers going on strike in that context. And are they going on strike against the robot? Well, sort of. I mean, the way we'd think of it is that they're going on strike against the owner of the robot, the owner of the camera. But unless the robots have like completely taken over, it's sort of the same thing. And even if robots do take over, why would someone be less willing to go on strike because Jeff Bezos owns the camera than if the camera owns itself?
Unfortunately, for technical reasons, I lost the last minutes of the footage. At the end, we mentioned that the best way to stay in touch with Phil's research is to check out his website, philtrammell.com, where he publishes drafts and blogs about his research. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something about economics, like I did when researching this topic. If you enjoy those kind of technical videos with diagrams, let me know in the comments so I make more of them. You can also DM me on Twitter at Michael Trazzi, T-R-A-Z-Z-I, link in the description. for more video suggestions. That's all for me. See you in the next video.